The new subject which we are going to learn in this semester is Harbour and Port Engineering. So let's begin now with the first session of this subject. First of all, let us go through the contents which we will be covering in today's session, that is the first session. So basically, we will be discussing about the introduction to the water transportation part, and the few contents which we will be covering today are firstly the history of water transportation. What are the various aspects related to the history of water transportation, classification of water transportation, and what are the advantages and disadvantages of water transportation. So these are the various features which we will be discussing in today's session. So let's begin with the first topic in our today's session, that is related to the history of water transportation. So basically, before studying in depth or in detail about water transportation, about the various elements, various features, various engineering aspects which we will be learning in this portion, that is the harbor engineering portion, we need to be aware about a few historical terms, about a few historical parameters. So that is the first topic. Waterways have great importance in development of the civilization and in growth of the nations. It is a self-understood point which we have learned in our school time as well, that how the waterways have played an important role in the development of various civilizations, which takes us back to many years before, and also in growth of nations as a whole. Basically, those nations which have rich water resource or are surrounded by waterways have few advantages with reference to those countries which don't have those facilities. So that waterway by which they are surrounded, the water resource which they have, plays a very vital role in the development or the growth of the nation as a whole. So that is the first point. The river and seas were utilized as first facility for mass transportation of goods. So that is again an historical aspect, that many years back, basically the rivers and seas, that are the water bodies, were utilized as the first facility, foremost facility for mass transportation, that is transportation in bulk for various goods and cargo and even of passengers as well. The heavy loads such as timber, stone and grain could be carried in large quantities only through water transportation, signifying its importance. So basically, one advantage which the water transportation had, and previously that was the only mode of transportation which was being used. So the heavy materials or the heavy loads, the material in bulk such as timber or stone or grain, could be carried in bulk, that is in large quantity, only through use of water transportation. So that was the one specific advantage that transportation had with reference to other modes or other ways. It still that advantage is prevailing as well. Civilizations that learned to build and sail ships were proposed as centers for trade, culture and power. So whichever civilizations that had the rich water resource, that had the surrounding waterways, learned to build and sail ships, that is the mode through which water transportation can be done, and having that advantage, having that specific facility which other centers or other civilizations did not have, proposed their centers or gave their centers an advantage regarding trade, that is due to the presence of a waterway facility, they could become a hub for trade, which ultimately led to the development of culture and also of power, because that was the area, that were the civilizations where trade was being carried out, where goods were being available. So that was an advantage with reference to water transportation. Ancient mariners used sea to explore the world for trade and to conquer other empires. So due to the existence of waterway, the mariners used to explore the world, and even as we talked about the trade aspect, that is the civilizations which were rich in water resource had the chance of carrying out trade and developing a superpower, and also while conquering other empires or other lands which were unconquered, the waterway, the water resource played a vital role. Next, talking about the importance of water transport. So basically these are in short the various aspects related to the importance of water transport. Water transportation is concerned with the conveyance of peoples and goods in vehicles that float upon water. So basically the vehicles which are the ship or vessels which are floating on the water body itself carry the people or passengers and goods. Waterways have a great historic importance in the development of civilization and growth of nation, as we discussed in the previous slide itself. Rivers and seas provide primitive man with his first facility for mass transportation of goods. So this is again a point which we already discussed, that the first and foremost mode of transportation was water transportation, and even through which the materials could be carried in bulk. The waterways are basically classified in two types. It is the oceanic waterways and inland waterways. So nextly, we'll be learning as to what is the meaning of oceanic waterway related to ocean and inland waterways, that is in the same country itself. So now let's learn about the classification of water transportation. As we discussed that there are two types. So firstly, we'll be talking about the inland waterways. Basically the two categories which we saw in the previous slide itself. So as the word used is inland, so here the inland waterways consists of water transportation on rivers, lakes and canals within the mainland. So basically the water transportation which takes place within the same territory, that is termed as the inland waterway. And the water sources which are basically used here are the rivers, lakes or canals. So as we can see here that there is no mention of ocean here. So it is basically the transportation taking place in the same territory. The Ganga Canal and Yamuna Canal are used for transportation of agricultural products. So that is the canal which is in the same territory, in one territory only, that is, it is not connecting to different nations or to different territories. So it is an example of transportation of agricultural products. It is an example of inland waterway. So continuing with the classification part, next is the oceanic waterway. So the word itself is derived from the word ocean. So consists of conveyance or transportation of people and goods primarily across the ocean between continents, that is, it could be between two different continents or it could be between different islands. So basically the international trade takes place through oceanic waterways, and the national trade, that is the products which are to be transported in the same country itself, takes place through inland waterways. So the international trade, that is the 75% of the total trade, is carried out by ships in oceans. And basically whenever we talk about the import-export operations, then those take place amongst two countries through these oceanic waterways. Next, talking about the advantages of water transportation. So what are the various advantages? First, development of commercial and industrial trade. That is, whenever we talk about the import-export operations mainly done through the water transportation, the cargo or commodity are being carried in bulk and can be carried in excessive amount by use of water transportation. So development of commercial activities, that is, it also in that manner leads to the growth of trade and development with reference to the economical terms as well, and growth of industrial trade as well, that is, growth of various industries through those exchange of commodities amongst two different territories. So that is the first advantage. Next is the development of agriculture, that is, certain commodity which is being grown in a certain territory or in a certain country can be transported to other countries, other territories. And in same manner, if a certain commodity is needed in a specific region, then that can be brought, that can be imported as well, mainly through use of the water transportation. So that is the second point. Next is the assistance at time of defense in emergency of national security. We are already aware about Navy. So at the time of defense, that is whenever certain sort of activities are taking place by which we need to take care of our territory or our region, then in that case, at the time of defense, in the case of emergency for national security, the water resources play a vital role. Easy and cheap mode of communication. So basically, whenever we talk about water transportation, the mode is a very simple and easier one, that is not much amount of fuss is there while using this mode, and also it is the cheapest mode of transportation with reference to other modes, that is air mode, or if you talk about roadway, railway, then basically the cheapest mode is the waterway. High load carrying capacity. So this is a point which we basically discussed up till now, that whenever the materials are supposed to be carried in bulk in excessive amount, then the specific advantage or specific advantage is with reference to water transportation, that is, it would be the most beneficial, most optimum one. Next advantage is cheap power, that is, if we talk about the manual power which is needed or motive required, that is, even if we talk about machineries or through which the operation of a particular ship is being carried out, then the power requirement, the monetary terms, that is, the amount needed for movement of a particular ship is very less. So that is the advantage in terms of monetary terms or in terms of money. Encourages consumption of domestic as well as foreign goods. So both the types of goods, that is of a specific country, or even if it is bought from other territory or other country, and various commodities can be exchanged via import export. So this point we have already discussed up to now. Next and the last content of the last topic for today's session are the disadvantages of water transport. So what are the specific disadvantages? First point is the high amount of loss in life and materials which may result due to frequent storms. So whenever we are moving through the waterways, we are aware about the word storm, so that might create a problem, and that is a specific disadvantage with this mode, that due to storm, due to any natural calamity, any natural phenomena, there might be high amount of loss in terms of life and for materials as well. Requires more time due to slow speed. So whenever we talk about different modes of transportation, basically this is the slowest mode of transportation. So that is a specific disadvantage as well. It takes more time. Is for foreign countries to attack on the naval crafts. So basically, if the water resource or the waterway are kept unprotected, and that is sort of a vulnerable situation, that is, if any foreign country wants to attack, then the water resource or waterway is a vulnerable source, and that could aid in any foreign countries beginning to attack the specific region. So that has to be kept under constant watch. Potential risk of pollution due to oil spillage from vessels. Now this is a sort of activity which we have come across many a times in the news as well, that whenever the ship or vessels are moving through the waterway, then oil spillage has taken place many a times in the past, which pollutes the water resource itself. Next is the noise pollution from the noise constantly being generated through the mode or through the ship which is traveling through the waterway. And lastly is the air pollution as well, that is the smokes or fumes which are being released from the ship. So it creates noise and air pollution, and moreover the oil spillage leads to the, we can say, sort of deteriorating the condition of water resource itself. Waterfalls may hinder transportation through water. So whenever whatever the sort of route is there, if any waterfall is existing on that route, then it might create a big hindrance at the time of making the movement. Operation of loading and unloading might be severely affected at time of high range of tides. So as we discussed in the introductory session regarding the natural phenomena, so basically tide is one amongst them. And whenever, if we are carrying out the loading and unloading operation, and if the harbor is sort of unprotected or is sort of partly protected, then the high range of tides might have its effect at the time of carrying out the operations. So that is a specific disadvantage at the time of carrying out the operation, that is loading and unloading operation at a specific site. So that's it for this introduction part of harbor engineering. It was the introduction to harbor engineering portion. From the next session, we will be beginning with the main portion, that are the main chapters of harbor engineering part, and we will be beginning with chapter number 2, that is harbor planning. So that's it for today's session.